want to start our look at chapter 4 of Don Quixote, part 1, with an image that helps us reflect on the meaning of the previous chapter and many to come. The Burghers of Calais is a bronze statue by Auguste Rodin, sculpted in 1888. Like Don Quixote, Rodin focuses on the medieval past. In 1347, at the beginning of the Hundred Years' War, the French city of Calais, on the coast of the English Channel, El Canal de la Mancha in Spanish, was besieged by the forces of Edward III of England. Philip VI of France ordered the city to resist at all costs. In the end, Edward III offered to respect the lives of the residents of Calais if 6 of its most remarkable men surrendered to him, dressed in nightclothes, carrying the keys of the city, and with a rope tied around each of their necks. There was discussion in the city, but soon one of the richest men stood up and said, "It would be a disgrace to allow these people to starve if we can find an alternative." 5 others soon joined him, offering to sacrifice themselves. What is the point of this story? It's a warning. Merchants are fallible human beings like the rest of us, but if we lash out at them simply because they are rich, bad results follow for everyone. In chapter 4, we find Don Quixote so happy to be knighted that his joy almost bursts the straps of his horse. He intends to comply with the innkeeper's advice that he provision himself with money and shirts, and already he plans to hire a neighbor who is a poor farmer with children, but very apropos for the squirely office. All this is hilarious, but careful. Cervantes is setting us up. Now we will investigate the difficult relationship at the foundation of commerce, that between employer and employee, or master and servant in the 16th century. We come upon a primal scene, a comic version of the master-slave dialectic in Hegel. Don Quixote hears delicate cries as if from a suffering person which emanate from the dense woods. He concludes that this is his first opportunity to fulfill the duties of his new profession. What we have here is a version of the ancient fable of the boy who cried wolf. The difference is that Andrés is being punished harshly for whatever the wolf has done. Juan Aldulo, a wealthy farmer, is whipping the boy because he does not keep proper watch over a flock of sheep, and every day one goes missing. According to the era's customs, Aldulo was entitled to beat Andrés, but Don Quixote does not hesitate to rescue the boy and even forces the farmer to promise to pay him his entire salary. There is irony and humor here alongside brutality. First, remember that at the end of the previous chapter, Don Quixote left the inn without paying. Second, our hero is not very good at math. Andrés informs him that Aldulo owes him for 9 months at 7 reals a month. Don Quixote multiplied this out and found that it came to 73 reals. Some editors believe that this was Cervantes' error. They are mistaken. In fact, things are likely even more complicated. Is Don Quixote really that stupid? Or might he have added a fine, perhaps even interest, for the time value of the unpaid salary? In any case, it is significant that Aldulo quibbles over the amount he owes the boy, because one must keep in mind and deduct the 3 pairs of shoes he had given him, and also a real for the 2 bleedings that he was given when he was sick. Don Quixote will not accept excuses and observes, "If he broke the leather of the shoes you bought him, you have broken that of his body. Therefore," he concludes, "he owes you nothing." Aldulo tells the knight that he has no money on him. Recall the innkeeper's advice to Don Quixote, but he offers to pay Andrés what he owes him at home. Andrés is in disbelief and expresses his doubt symbolically, noting that once the knight is gone, the farmer is going to flay him like a Saint Bartholomew. We will return to this idea of the evil master refusing to pay a servant, whom he then literally skins alive. Naive and overconfident of his own abilities, Don Quixote says he trusts Aldulo's word. In the end, the farmer swears by all the orders of chivalry in the world that he will pay the boy 1 real after another, and "I'll even put perfume on them." This idea of paying Andrés his retroactive salary perfumed means with interest. And like the decaying hooves of Rocinante, the point of Don Quixote's reaction is to underline again the problem of currency devaluation. "I absolve you of perfuming," said Don Quixote. "Just give it to him in reals, and with that I'll be content." In other words, as long as Aldulo pays Andrés what he owes him in silver coins, not copper ones, then the interest can be excused, because unlike quarters, reals will have maintained their value. At the end of the episode, Arturo returns to his evil ways and starts whipping Andrés again. We should note the cinematographic style that Cervantes uses to describe this sadistic transformation. The farmer followed him with his eyes, and when he saw that he had cleared the woods and vanished from view, he turned to his servant Andrés and said, "Come here, my son, for I want to pay you what I owe you," adding with bitter sarcasm, "I want to increase the debt so I can increase the payment." And on top of all this, we have another example of a character mocking Don Quixote by imitating his ridiculous language. "Now you can call Mr. Andrés," said the farmer, "the great writer of wrongs. You'll see how he can't right this one." Meanwhile, Don Quixote, very pleased with himself, proceeds. Pay close attention to the way he narrates for himself the conclusion of his very first feat as a knight. "Today he has righted the greatest wrong and grievance ever formulated by injustice, sin razón, and perpetuated by cruelty. Today he took the whip from the hand of that ruthless oppressor who for no reason did flog that tender child." At this point, Don Quixote comes across a road that was divided into four, in other words, a crossroads, where the knights of his favorite books often find themselves.